Okay, hi, thank you for coming. Well, we are going to start a kind of 3 days tutorial, okay, about probabilistic programming and variational inference. But first, I want to thank the organizer for inviting me to be here in such a nice university. Actually, I was employed here as a postdoc a couple of years, even though I didn't live in Norway. I was living in Denmark for some reasons in the project, but well, it was such a nice time for me, and it's really great to be to come back here. So I'm gonna start describing a bit, okay, the 3 days workshop. So today we are gonna speak about probabilistic programming languages, which is a really hot topic currently in machine learning and artificial intelligence. We are going to give some introduction to Python, okay, some probabilistic programming language, which is quite popular nowadays. Even though it's not going to be a tutorial about Python, some like just an introduction to probabilistic programming languages, but using Python, okay, as an example. Because most of the concepts that we are going to explain applies to many other probabilistic programming languages. Then tomorrow, we are going to focus on variational inference. During the morning, we will give a lot of details about variational inference, and then the idea is during the afternoon, you will have kind of exercises, making some derivation of variational equations in order to get to have a deep knowledge about what's behind this powerful inference method. We will simplify it with variational linear regression, factor analysis, just simple model, because this variational inference will apply to a very limited set of models, the ones that are called conjugate exponential family models. And then on day three, we'll go to the last developments in variational inference, especially this development that makes the connection between probabilistic modeling and deep learning. They have been able to join these two different fields recently. And then we will have a look about black box variational inference, how it's implemented, and how can be coded in Pyro, how Pyro exploits this model variational inference methods, and we will simplify that with variational encoders, which is a very popular deep generative model. We are going to give just an introduction to the deep generative model, just to introduce this this model, but on day four you will learn much more about that. Okay, let me start. So the idea is, we wanted to start with a motivation to probabilistic programming languages. So why probabilistic programming languages are becoming so popular in the last 2-3 years? So the question is that people has realized, especially now that machine learning is so broad, applied in many different fields and many different companies, that the development of a machine learning system requires enormous effort. No? I mean, sometimes there is a kind of bubble, you know, this hype. It seems to be like it's going to be quite easy to develop a machine learning model, and then I have a lot of data, okay, yes, I take a machine learning model, then I find an easy solution, I can develop a new product, I can extract a lot of information, I can make a lot of money, or I can make a lot of fancy stuff. But the reality is that developing of a machine learning system is quite complex. So there are many factors that make that this a very complex process. First of all, it requires of highly qualified experts. This is true. So one guy that really wants to develop a real machine learning system needs to have knowledge about computer science, good knowledge about computer science. You need to have a good training in math and statistics, and also need to have a good knowledge of the business problem that you are trying to solve. And this is not easy to find, because all of that requires a lot of effort. More things. When you're developing a machine learning model, I mean, I'm not thinking about a general machine learning model like a linear regression or, you know, a deep convolutional neural network. I mean, a real machine learning model, I mean, it's something like it's a bug, which is in most of the relevant cases should be developed. We should use a bug machine learning models. So what we face is that there are a lot of possibilities, okay? This is just a cheat sheet for the exercise to learn about what machine learning models they choose. You can see there are many different options. Okay? And we are not including here, for example, things that come when we are using deep learning networks. You have to define the architecture, you have to define hyperparameters, the number of layers. There are many different factors and many different types of machine learning models, and not everybody has a good knowledge in order to know which is the best one to be applied to solve my problem. And furthermore, Machine learning, when you build a machine learning model, it's not only about the machine learning model, it's also around the ecosystem, the set of tools that you need in order to make this machine learning model available and in a real setting in production, as they usually say. This is a very nice paper, okay, where they describe that, made by Google Folks, okay. And they can you see here, this is just the piece of the relevant machine learning programming. There are many different models that have to be taken into account in order to develop a true machine learning system, like configuration, data collection, feature extraction, the same infrastructure monitoring. Because sometimes when we train our model, we need to send data, but data is not static, the data changes. And then we have to be careful because the performance of the models may start to increase, and maybe we need to collect more data and retrain our model again. Okay? So what's the other consequence of all of that? Well, first of all, there's a shortage of AI experts. Okay? There's much more demand than people who is qualified. Okay? And what is happening that the wage salary is very high. And also it's making that people who have not the right knowledge comes into the field, not what they can. But good people with a good knowledge is very difficult to find. Okay? And this is, yes, that's the issue. And the final consequence of all of that is that only big corporations or big institutions, the ones that have enough resources, can really afford to develop complex and real and good machine learning systems. So we are in a similar situation that we were 50 years ago. So there are many people that think that. Okay? For example, the DARPA agency, the American DARPA agency, they make a special call for research funds about collective programming languages because they wanted to address this problem. Okay. The idea is, when we were 50 years ago, when computers started to be applied to many different systems, many different problems, and many different places, and the people were very excited, okay, about the possibility of computers. But the problem was that we have to use, at the beginning, low-level programming languages, okay? And that was an issue, because programming these low-level programming languages was complex and demand very high expertise. Not everybody was able to code in low-level programming languages. And of course, when you develop such a kind of code, you have to focus on the application and also on low-level hardware details. Then you have to know the RAM, the size, how the architecture of the CPU even. I mean, this really, it was very painful to develop. Even though they run too fast, the development of this kind of software with this kind of programming languages was really big. Then high-level programming languages arrived, okay? And the next thing is like, then programmers couldn't start to focus on applications. Then the hardware experts couldn't start to focus on compilers, okay? Then what happens is that there was a high gains in productivity, okay? The code was slower, yes, that's true. But we consider the whole development cycle, it was much shorter, okay? Once you have the idea, until you have developed your software, all these projects were much shorter when high-level programming languages than that was possible before. And at the end, what arrives for kind of democratization of the software development, okay? You have to think about that 50 years later, kids are taught how to code, okay? So it's something which is not completely unbelievable. 50 years ago, we said just only high expertise people with high expertise was able to code in low-level programming languages. So the idea is that PPLs are expected, that's the idea, that they're expected to have a similar impact that high-level programming languages have when coding computers. Now, political programming languages are expected to have similar impact when developing machine learning or AI problems or solutions. First, PPLs rely on a stack architecture, okay, similar to high-level programming languages. So on top of the stack, there are the domain experts. So there is a domain expert. It has to be mainly belong to a different field from computer science. I mean, biology, environmental modeling. So Antonio has so many different, very nice examples. Okay. Then the different domain expert knowledge will code the models using the PPL, the probabilistic programming language, always using the same API, the same language. And then the machine learning expert, the experts in machine learning, they will focus on the development of machine learning software. That's like the compiler. Okay? So which is like the math and the hardcore stuff is. And then the compilers will focus on running these machine learning software on specialized hardware. You know, GPUs, TPUs. So there's a clear stack architecture. Okay, well, the expertise of everybody will be focused on solving a specific problem. And then we can build on top of each other, okay? Which is something which is not really happening right now. So it is something like, with PBL, we'll be able to simplify machine learning model code, we'll reduce the development time and cost to develop a machine learning system, and in that way we'll encourage experimentation, so different models could be built, and we can try different models, okay, and that should be quick. So we should facilitate the construction of more sophisticated models. Sometimes we just go to very simple models just because we don't know how to code them or how to develop the specific learning algorithm for such a specific machine learning model. They would reduce the necessary level of expertise, so they should be easier. Okay. And finally, we hope that they bring the kind of democratization to the machine learning, to developing machine learning system that the same way that probabilistic programming languages deal with computers. Well, I want to start making kind of division of PBLs because PBLs have been around for a long time, no? And then I want you to make you to have an idea about what is happening right now in the field of PBLs and why there are so many expectations with PBLs and there are so many people working on PBLs right now. Well, PBLs have been around for the last 30 years or so, okay? So there were this kind of, we call it, okay, first generation or one class of PBLs, was bugs, mean bugs, familiar one, JAX, figure, which is a little bit more modern. So the idea of these PBLs is that they could represent any computable probability distribution, okay? So probabilistic modeling was a lot of focus on PBLs, for example, but PBLs, they only represent a part of the possible probability distribution. So the modeling capacity of these of classic PBLs was quite limited. So the idea with PBL, when they started to work on that, is that okay, you wanted to define a language which could really represent any probabilistic programming, any computable probability distribution. The idea of this first generation of PBLs is that the inference was based on Monte Carlo methods. Okay? It was nice because Monte Carlo, they are quite general, to very general probabilistic models, but the issue is that they didn't scale to large data sample or models with a large number of parameters. So that was a big barrier, and they couldn't be applied to many relevant problems where there was a lot of data and a lot of parameters. Okay? Then there was a second generation of PBLs, especially like this one, if I got that, developed by Microsoft. So they took a different approach. They said, okay, we're going to limit the probabilistic model family. Okay, we are going to consider factor graphs, which is a quite general probabilistic model class. And then they base the inference engine on a kind of message passing algorithm with variational difference. Okay, the idea is something like they were able to scale to very big problems. Okay, for example, inference model has been applied to many problems related with Microsoft. Okay, when they involve a very computer with very large scale probabilistic models, and they work well. Okay, the problem is they started to have limitation, and the limitation was that okay, this probabilistic model class was quite general, but then especially the deep learning arrived, and you know, and when they started to be applied this model to deep learning problems like image recognition, object recognition, speech synthesis, and all these deep learning problems, I mean, this model family becomes too restricted to be able to model this kind of problem. So, what is happening now in the last 3 years, 4 years or so, okay, is that it's been developed a new generation of PBLs, okay? Motivated by the limitation of the previous generation of PBLs, but especially motivated by what I've been talking at the beginning about is how to make simpler the development of probabilistic and machine learning systems. So, there is a version of TensorFlow, which is called TensorFlow Probability, so Google has been investing a lot of money in developing one of these tools. There is also Pyro, okay, which is also being recently released by Uber, this Bahraini company. And this also, this is Pioneer 3, which is a research project, but it's really good and has been here for a long time. InfraPyre, which is the ones we are involved in our research lab, it's also another similar third generation of PPLs. And what they all have in common is they rely on black box directional inference. Okay? This is something that you will learn on day 3, okay? And also on day 4, which is very general variational inference algorithm, which is not restricted, which was not like the previous generation of variational inference algorithm that was restricted to a specific model family. And then it is something like they did escape to large data samples and high-dimensional models because of these powerful inference engines. Of course, they are now able to compute they are Turing complete in the sense that they can compute any, so they can represent any computable probability distribution. And the idea, this is the great success of these PPLs, is that they rely on deep learning frameworks. So the inference engine, the computing engine down there, is one of these inference engines. For example, TensorFlow Probability is TensorFlow, PolPy is PyTorch, PolPy is C3 is Theano, for InfraPy is also TensorFlow. So all the computations are made in one of these deep learning frameworks, which are highly optimized and they scale quite well. And the nice thing is, by doing that, we can have probabilistic inference engines that they exploit the specialized hardware like GPUs or TPUs. And this is quite nice because they can also exploit this automatic differentiation method, which is much very well with variational inference. Okay? But you will see much more details about variational inference in the coming days. Okay? But that's a motivation. Okay? Why this third generation of PPS, they are having so much impact and they are very active in your research right now. Well, the idea is that we are going to speak about pilots, okay? Any of them can be used to represent the kind of models and kind of inference that we are going to make here. But we use pilot, okay, because, okay, there is backed by very nice strong company with very nice research team. And this model is also focused on deep generative model with much about with the things that we will see on day 4. And rely on PyTorch, okay, which is quite nice because it's not like this lazy evaluation. It's much easier to debug PyTorch. There is the dynamic computational graph. I don't know if you're familiar with deep learning frameworks, but for research, PyTorch is quite nice. And of course, well, as I said before, enable this GPU acceleration, okay, which makes that your probabilistic model will scale to very large problems. So, now we are going to start to speak about Pyro. Okay? So the idea is that you download the notebooks that we have provided in the GitHub repo. You should have the GitHub repo. They send it around, the link. But if you don't have it, I can just give it to you. I mean, if you go to github.com/pmlab, okay, there is a repository which is called Probabilistic AI Tutorials. github.com/pmlab. And then you will find it down here, the link to the repo with the tutorials. And if you go here, you can clone and download the repo. Okay. If any of you is not familiar with GitHub or download a GitHub repo, just you may, you know, try your hand and maybe we can help you out. Okay? Maybe one could just add that we will, in not so short time, have a small exercise session where you have a chance to play around with one of the notebooks that we put up. And there we can also help you download the material from GitHub. So in not so short time, in a short time we'll have around a small exercise session where, as I mentioned before, we can assist you in downloading the material for today, the slides, the notebooks and so forth, and help you setting up Python and Pyro to the extent that you need. I think we'll just continue with the tutorial now, and then we'll return to the practicalities once the exercise session starts. So I'll take over now, and Andrés will then come in and interrupt when I forget something or omit some details. But you are also welcome to chip in if you have some comments on your own, if you all have some familiarity with other languages that you would like to supplement with, or if you have some questions, then just say so, and then we'll just take it online. Yes. I tried to synchronize the slides in the notebook, so I'll be jumping back and forth here. This is a snapshot of the notebook that you'll also get access to and you get a chance to play around with. But for now, what we'll do is to start looking into the probabilistic programming language Pyro and the basic constructs that you find there. So, and Andrés have been talking about both the modeling part of the aspect of modeling using probabilistic programming languages and the underlying machinery that allows you to perform inference with these probabilistic programming languages. But today we're going to focus only on the modeling part and leave all the details about inference. We'll leave that for tomorrow and day three instead. So it will only be about modeling, how to set up models using Pyro. So the basic model component that you have with Pyro are distributions. And Pyro allows you to work with a large variety of distributions, normal distribution, better distribution, direct distribution, and so forth. And they are handled by this expression that you have up here. In this case, for the normal distribution, you take a mean and a standard deviation, location on the scale, and these are these two values that we have up here. And we then get a variable and an object here corresponding to the normal distribution, and we have that specified here. Once we have a distribution, we can draw samples from it, and we use that with the Pyro's sample construct, normal dot sample. And in that case, if we run it with the notebook, we have the location here, we can sample, and we get a new value for, we sample a new value for the normal distribution here. And if we do it again, we get a new sample. Everything here is embedded into so-called tensors, which I would say a bit more about later, but for now suffice to say that in general, tensors should be considered a multidimensional array. In this case here, it's just the scalar that we're working with. We can also take
directly generate multidimensional arrays or tensors, and we do that by, in this case here, specifying a sample shape explicitly for the normal distribution. So in this case here, it's a tensor with dimensions 3, 4, and 5. So we have a three-dimensional tensor with a number of numbers in it. And this is then one sample generated from a sample from this normal distribution. Yes. We can perform various operations on these tensors. For instance, the rule of likelihood. Just put down here, calculated rule of likelihood. So Antonio was talking about that before for doing, for instance, maximum likelihood estimation, which also would become relevant here. And we have these operations that are directly supported by Pyro, and they're also optimized for the hardware that you have available. You can also embed multiple distributions within the objects. So in this case, we have here, we define a normal distribution here, and it's supplies for the location. We have a tensor consisting of three elements, 1, 2, and 3, and one scale of 1, and that means that we construct three normal distributions with different mean values, but with the same scale, and it's then expressed in the notation that we have here. Yes? Maybe I suggest too fast. I have a Spanish keyboard over here. Thank you. Okay, are there at this point any questions about these constructs here? So we have distributions that are defined directly, for instance, by list.normal, which is a module that's being included. You'll see that in your notebook, and you can sample from our distribution. These two components are the basic components that you'll be using for constructing probabilistic models. And that is what we will be looking at after you have a chance to check that your notebooks are running. So we'll just take a small exercise test session here where we'll help you download the notebooks. Please check that you have there are some requirements specified on the GitHub page about the packages that you need in order to run the notebooks. So you need to install them also, and if you have problems doing that, just raise your hand and we'll come around. And then try to go through the code that is listed under section 1 in the notebook. You'll also test that your implementation works correctly. And then we'll just go around and assist you now.
Thank you.
Hello. It seems that the cloning takes an extremely long time, but if you download a zip file, then it's much faster. So if you have problems cloning, try to download.
So the question is, you should download everything, no? And then there are the notebooks, and then you open Jupyter, and then you open the notebook with Jupyter. That's the question.
Thank you.
For those of you who want to use Google Colab, I won't be able to show it here, but before you start your Google Colab, you have to install Pyro on the Google Colab notebook. So in the case you're using, so you can do it like exclamation mark, P, install, Pyro, PL, and Torch. If you're doing Google Colab, that's all.
No, 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 no,
How many is struggling with the implementation? The doctor, if you could raise your hand for those who are not able to run it yet. So we have one over here. Two, three, four, five. Tutorial here, and then I just have a bit more material to present, and then we'll have an exercise session. And for those who haven't been able to run the notebook at this point in time, we'll come around and help you again, trying to see the solve the last issues. I have the impression that most of you are able to run it now. But we'll take another round, helping you out with the next exercise. Okay.
So, nice and done there. I bought some glasses and keep it.
Yeah, okay, so we'll continue now. And again, if you were able to get the notebook up and running, we'll come around you around and help you with the next in the next exercise session. So now we see the use of pyro distributions from which we can generate distribution objects, and we have the sample construct that allows us to sample tensors, multidimensional arrays from these distributions. And these two components are the building blocks for Pyro's models, which are the, basically the probabilistic modeling constructs that are used within the Pyro language. But again, as Andrés also mentioned earlier, then Pyro here is just an example of a probabilistic programming language. There was another one among the audience here who talked, who asked whether the same thing could be done using languages building on top of TensorFlow, and that is indeed the case. So it's not something that is limited to Pyro. It's just an example of how to make probabilistic programming using this programming language. So when we define a model in Pyro is a stochastic function, which is can be expressed like this. So you have defined your model, a function, and you define your stochastic variable, or random variable temperature in this case here. And the random variable here is then defined as a sample that is, comes from a normal distribution, which in this case here we specify it with a location of 15 and a standard deviation of 2. And the random variable here is also giving a name. In this case here, it's giving the string name temp. And we will see the importance of proper name usage in the models later on when we start to talk about, when we start to do inference. But at this point in time, it's just important to note that all random variables that you specify in your models should always be given a name. And then in this case here, we return the temperature, and if we then run our model, which we see over here, then we will get samples from the temperature. And in this case here, we run it twice, so we get two different samples of two different values embedded within a tensor. Yes. And we can also construct larger, more interesting probabilistic models. And it's basically just defined as a composition of these primitive stochastic functions we can define through sample and the distribution objects that is embedded within the language. So if we, for instance, take this very simple Bayesian network over here that consists of a temperature that represents sort of the real temperature within a room, for instance, and we have able to measure the temperature using a sensor. The sensor is not perfect, so it's associated with some noise. So we can represent this relationship that we have graphically shown over here. We can illustrate the qualitative part of this structure using the code over here, but also the numeric part here, the probabilities that goes into the model. So for the first part, the temperature that we've just seen before, we have that on top, and then we have the sensor defined below. Again, it's defined, it's a sample that is being generated from a normal distribution with a standard deviation of 1, and with a mean that is given by the value that we have for the temperature variable. And then we can return the temperature, and we can return the sensor here as a tuple, as a joint object, a sample for both these two. And that would define basically a joint probability distribution like Antonio discussed with you earlier. And in this case here, the values that we returned here, this here is the value of the temperature variable, and the value that we have over here is the value for the sensor variable given this particular sensor value that we just sampled. And this is a sample from a model object. So this is how we define joint distributions, how we can sample from joint distributions. And you can also see that if we run the notebook over here, here we have our model down here, and we can generate our values that we have here, and it has this corresponding graphical illustration. Now, once we have our models, then as Antonio also talked about earlier, what we actually want to do is to do inference. Given observations about a subset of the variables included in our model, we want to find posterior distributions of all the remaining variables or subset of the remaining variables. But inference in either case is our main goal. And with Pyro, how to introduce do inference, and that basically means inserting evidence about which variables are observed, is done in the model specification that we have here. Specifically in this example, we define our observations by having a variable ops, which is a dictionary consisting, in this case here, we define the element here, the name sensor, and it has a value corresponding to an observation of 18 degrees. And again, this here is embedded within a torch tensor, which is again the objects that we're going to use with for numerical values. And our model now takes as argument the data that we have observed, the observation, and we embed the observations within the model using the construct over here. So we have the pyro sample sensor distribution normal, and we specify that it's observed by assigning a value to this observed statement here. And if we give the value to this ops variable here, the ops parameter here, as the value assigned to the sensor that we supplied it. In this case here, 18 degrees. And once we've done that, we can use our model to perform inference. And in this case here, we would like to calculate our posterior distribution of the true temperature given the observation that we've just entered, 18 degrees. And this is just an application of Bayes' rule that Antonio talked about. So we have the joint distribution up here, and we then divide with the marginal distribution or the marginal probability of the sensor value that we have just observed to be 18. In the notebook that you'll see, or that I've illustrated up here, I have embedded all the calculation of the code for running, doing posterior inference within the function called SVI. And we will try to hide all the code details in the presentation. You can still find them in the notebook, but just disregard them at the moment. It's something that we'll return to one of the later days. Today it's only about the modeling part. But just to let you know that in this case here, the inference that's being done, which is capacitor ratio inference, it takes the model that we have here, and it takes a so-called guide, which corresponds to a variational distribution, which you will hear more about later. And then in this case here, it also indicates that we want to do some nice plotting afterwards. And if we run this part here, what we can generate is then here. I just skip over this part here. This is the part that you shouldn't worry about. We have our observation, and we run our guide, define our guide, and then we can do inference. And what we inference is now running over here, and what we will get out of it is a probability distribution. In this case, the updated probability distribution for our temperature variable. It's a normal distribution in this case here with an updated mean of 17 point something and a scale of 0.9. What we have up here is an illustration of what happens during inference. So at this point, probably have an inkling about it already. When you do variational inference, you're basically doing optimization. And with optimization, you're trying to minimize a loss function. And what we see up here is an illustration of how the loss that is being minimized during inference evolves over time, so the number of time steps that we run this. But this is sort of a more of a curioso for you for the later days that you can look at. So this is doing inference for a single observation. We can also do inference if we have multiple observations, which would probably be a more interesting case when we talk about learning also. So doing inference for multiple observations is very much the same. So in this case here, I define now, I extend my observation variable from before, where I have the observation construct, I have my sensor, and now I define my, I have a bunch of observations, I embed that within a torch tensor. So I had observation of day, let's say day 1 at 18 degrees, then day 2 18.7 degrees. So we are definitely not in Trondheim here, and we, in our model here, we want to embed these observations within our model, and we do that by taking a for loop, where we iterate from 0 up to the number of observations that we have in our observation set here. So that's the range from 0 up to the number of observations. Shape 0 indicates, in this case here, it takes the shape of the tensor, so the multidimensional array, and pick out the first dimension, and that corresponds to the length of the sequence here, and this is sort of the range of which we iterate over. And in each iteration, we construct a temperature variable and a sensor variable, and the sensor variable are then given the observation corresponding to the ith observation, the observation on the ith day. So this is how we would embed our observation sequence within our model. And we create random variables for each observation. So in the model that we have here, I have explicitly indicated what I expect to be the average temperature of the day. So here, I have an idea that we are now going into the summer in Norway, so we are talking about 15 degrees here. But what if I was not unsure about, I didn't know the average temperature that I expected to see. In that case, I can introduce the mean temperature, I can make that unknown, and express that in terms of a parameter. So this here is a new construct that we haven't encountered before. We have that up here, pyro parameter, mean temperature. So I get here, mean temperature here is the name of my parameter, which corresponds to the mean temperature of the day, the mean temperature that I expect within this period of time. And I assign that as an initial value. So it's just an initial value that I assign, which I can refine based on the data that I observe. This is part of the inference mechanism. But it's assigned a default value here of 15, and I still have my loop that iterates over the number of samples that I have in my data set up here. And for, in this case here, rather than using a fixed value, which I had before, if I go back one slide, you see I had a fixed value here of 15 degrees. I now instead introduce the mean temperature that I've defined as an unknown parameter that I would like to learn. So I would like to find this parameter. Yes. And if we look at it from a graphical models perspective, illustrating using the language that Antonio introduced before lunch, then our model looks like this. So we have this repetitive structure here. This is for day one. This here is for day n. We have a temperature variable, we have a sensor variable. They are linked, as you would expect from a causal perspective, just as we saw before for a single day. And then we have a hyperparameter up here, which is this unknown parameter that I would like to estimate. I have not put a circle on this because it's a parameter that I have not assigned a distribution. So this is, I'm just trying to indicate here that it's a hyperparameter influencing my model. That determines the probability distribution of my model. When I do inference, I would like to find the value of this guy up here. But at this point in time, I don't put any distribution on it. So I look at it from a maximum likelihood perspective, if you are thinking in terms of learning, as Antonio talked about. So I can, with this model specification here, where I have my unknown parameters specified, I can do inference using this SVI method. And again, this is a method that I have kept hidden for you, so it's something that we'll go into details about that later. And you can run it and calculate the mean temperature of the parameter that we found. And as I sort of indicated before, this is what we're really doing here is maximum likelihood estimation. So we are trying to find the new, our hyperparameter for our model before, that maximizes the likelihood of the model, given the data that I have seen expressed like this. And it's the nice thing about this approach is that it's performed, you don't have to think about it as a maximum likelihood estimation when you look at it from a probabilistic programming perspective. The underlying mechanisms, you'll see that later, is completely equivalent whether you're doing optimization with respect to inference or you're doing optimization with respect to finding the maximum value. It's the same thing. So you could do maximum likelihood estimation. We can also do Bayesian inference, which is a more interesting part here. So if you want to capture the uncertainty about our estimate of the average temperature, so here we just have it again, the approach from before, where we don't provide probability distribution over it, but we could also assign it a distribution. Like we have it up here now, so we have mean temperature, this sample with the name mean temperature, comes from a normal distribution with mean 15, and now I also introduce my uncertainty up here by specifying a standard deviation of 2. So I've now expressed, I move from rather than having maximum likelihood estimation, I'm looking to perform Bayesian inference in this case now. And my model now looks like this. So what has happened is that I've changed this here rather than being a constant. It's now a random, a proper random variable that I would like to make an inference about. And I can do perform model updating here. Let's just try to follow up on the notebook. So here we had our maximum likelihood estimation from before. I'm a bit behind with this. So what we have up here is that we're doing Bayesian inference. We do again this SVI, stochastic variational inference method that takes the model and the dive now hidden or hidden so far. And number of steps here is again what's happening underneath is that we're doing an optimization, iterative optimization. And this is the number of steps that we want to perform before we convert, before we end. And then we plot out the distribution of the posterior distribution of our mean temperature that we had. And this is what we see down here. We have the probability of the mean, probability distribution of the mean temperature given our center values, this normal distribution with this mean and this scale of mean. And this is just the value that is actually being calculated here, again, using Bayes formula. And if we compare this with our maximum likelihood estimation from before, so if you get to maximum likelihood estimation, you get this vertical bar here, and if you do Bayesian inference and actually express your uncertainty about your estimates from the parameters, you have this nice curve here. So you get a more expressive result out of your inference, out of your analysis. Let's just see if we are now finished here. So this year we did, we have our doing inference. This is our maximum likelihood inference that is now running. And it takes a bit of time. We have our move to the Bayesian approach where we define uncertainty over here, uncertainty about our mean temperature. And we can do inference again and plot the results. Yes. Yes.
So assumptions fail to return anything. So where are these samples saved?
Where are the samples saved?
Yeah, so when you have a function with a sample, it's then you do something like type a sample.
Yeah.
And you don't see it anywhere or can return it explicitly.
Yes.
But higher saves it automatically somehow in the background.
Yeah, so, yeah. So yes, at the beginning we just put out, we call, statement, okay, just to give the people the impression that they can really see the samples.
Yeah.
Okay, but really all is happening under the hood, okay? Yes, samples are generated under the hood. I mean, they are transformed in tensors, and then the tensors are operated following within the computational graph within PyTorch and so on. But you don't need to introduce the return statement if you don't want. Okay.
Can I see what this
currently
is
saying, or
like
some projects? Well, yes. I mean, what you see is like every time this math of defining the model is run, is generated a sample. Okay, and then this sample condition the generation of the next sample, and so on. But this cannot really, I mean, I don't know, what do you really mean by it? No, you cannot really see the sample. No, you cannot really see the sample. Yes, I mean, exactly. But the question is, I mean, at the beginning we introduce a return statement, no? So you can write that in order to see the sample that you generate, okay? But what happens is during inference, okay, during inference, you don't need even to, they don't use the return statement. So you can access, the inference engine directly access to this pyro sample construct in order to get the samples. Okay? Yes?
So,
yes.
Yes. And we want to do math. What can we do? We want to just do math estimation.
Yes.
So then, if you say that there would be like a college factor, like the decomposition. So how we take the model?
You need math, no? So yes. For doing math, you have to blah blah blah. For doing math. So for the map, you have to go to the guide. Yeah. I think we can see that in the, we'll see that in Wednesday. You want to do that? Yes. That's true. This is not as straightforward. It's quite easy to move to maximum likelihood to variation because just as you saw, using just changing one line, pyro param by pyro sample. That's the same. But for doing map, it involves to go to the guide. Okay. Actually, let me tell you something else. So the question is, yes. I mean, usually when you define the... So? Okay. Yes, maybe we can discuss that. Okay, I need to comment. Yes, so, well... The question is that, okay, we've been working with this model, okay? And up to show, it's a bit late. Sorry, it's a bit slow, sorry. But it is the following. So here we can see that there are some conditional independencies. So given this guy, these guys over here are conditionally independent between them. So pyro doesn't really take care of that unless we tell explicitly pyro that there is a conditional independence. Okay, and this is quite nice because this is probably pyro's, for example, TensorFlow probability you cannot do, you can do that. Okay, but with pyro you can exploit these conditional independencies in order to make inference much faster. So the idea is that this is the code that we have before. Okay, we have one variable for each of the samples, for each of the observation. This is the real temperature for each of the days, and this is the mean temperature. Okay, but here we have used a formula, the standard formula from Python, okay? So what we can do is to tell Pyro that these guys are conditionally independent, the different repetition of these guys are conditionally independent between them, giving the samples up here. We can use this construct, which is called Pyro.proto, okay? Where we can specify how many times we want to repeat to expand all these random variables, you know? So we expanded, like before, just the length of the number of observations that we have. Okay? So it's just the same. The only thing now is we don't have this index attached to the observation. We just give directly to Pyro the vector of observation directly. Okay? And then Pyro knows, as I told you before, that this the different repetition of these guys of different repetitions, okay, of these guys are condition independent between them given this guy. This is one of the first things that exploits Spiral when making this when making volitional inference, or making inference in general. Another thing that exploits is like it performs which is called vectorization of vectorized operation. Okay? So instead of making just the computation down there, instead of making just one step at a time, okay, which is what happened here. For example, I just generate one sample, then I generate in the next iteration of the formula, I generate another sample. And just doing that, we generate a bunch of samples at a time, and then the operation that are performed with this bunch of samples in order to perform the additional inference and also perform altogether using vectorized operation over PyTorch, so things become much more quick. Okay. That would be the graphical representation. Okay. So now, instead of having this different, I mean, this is like standard Platon notation, as Antonio showed you before this morning. So these variables, the random variables are within a Platon structure. And this is like the global hidden variable, the parameter, okay, that influences this random variable, which is not observed. And I have the observation here, which are the sensor measurements. Okay? But all this is within a Platon. Okay? It means that it's replicated many times. Okay? So the question is, now we run the notebook, we will see that the running time is much slower than before. Before it was over 10 seconds, now it's much. Okay, it's can you see here? Okay, it was 10 seconds. Now we move here. Okay. And then we run it. Okay, and this is much faster. Okay, just by changing one line. Okay, but it's important to know that we should be sure that okay, these guys are condition independent between them. Okay? We will see later as an example when this condition dependency doesn't happen, we have temporal models. So this is something like depends on the one who is defining the model, but doing that, we are careful by doing that, we can really speed up around the device. Okay, so the question is now we have this code, okay? And then we have this mean temperature, this has treated as a Bayesian wave, and we have the planet, okay? So what we want you to do now is just to, okay, just by yourself, okay, you start to play around by changing the parameters of the planet, okay? And then you can really see how changing the parameters of the planet, how affects, I mean, your inference, your learning, how affects the posterior, okay? So one thing that you can do is like moving around the mean, making bigger and slower and smaller the scale, the standard deviation of the prior, and then have a look how the posterior changes. Okay? And this is related to the concept of Bayesian learning that Antonio had been showing so before this morning. Okay? So we also can also spend some time with those guys that are behind making work the notebook and so on, so yeah. We will let some minutes. I don't know if you want to say something.
Maybe you could just give an indication of whether you're still having problems with the notebook. Okay. Thanks.
Ah, yes. Okay. So maybe this is like a.
I don't know. just a quick update. For those that are having troubles with the installation, I just made this kind of an adaptation of these notebooks for Google Colab. So you can go to Probabilistic AI / tutorials GitHub. And there is this red page with some links. So there's day one, student PBL intro, student Bayesian regression. This is a Google Colab notebook that I just created. So you click on this one, for example, and then now you have the notebook. And the only thing you need to do is go to files and then click on save. And then you choose the option to save on your own drive. Because this is like from my drive shared, and then there will be some problem. But you do save and you import for your own drive, and then it's done. So you can run now. Okay? Yeah.
Thank you. We are going to move on. Okay? We are in behind the schedule. Okay? But well, we have a lot of material. So you have the notebooks. So the question is, after that we thought to do this kind of more elaborated toy example of artificial data, okay, just very simple toy example. About an ice cream shop, we have temperature, sensor measurement of temperature, we have sensor measurements of the humidity, okay? And then the guy who's running the ice cream shop thinks that the sales, the number of ice creams he sells every day is affected by the temperature and the humidity, okay? And then we want to build a probabilistic model about all of that, okay? So the idea is there in the notebook, you have all the details, okay? Then you have a first example, then you have the exercise, and then you can do that at home, because it will require to build this kind of more sophisticated model, okay? Where you have the sensor measurement for the temperature, the real temperature that cannot be observed, the humidity that cannot be observed, the sensor for the humidity that this is what we also observe the sales, but the sales are influenced, okay, by the real temperature and the real humidity, okay? And for example, here we have normals, but this is going to be a Poisson distribution. So this toy example will show you, okay, the flexibility that Pyro have in order to define a bit more complex model. So it's a bit more complex than you've seen before. Okay, there you have the lines, you have the notebook, and it is something like something to be do at home, okay, because we don't have time today. We will provide the solutions, okay, and this is like a nice exercise in order to get a better knowledge of Pyro, how to do it. Things a little bit more complicated, okay. Same happens with temporal models. In Pyro, you can also define temporal models. There is nothing special for defining temporal models. Okay, you just done everything with the same constructs: Pyro sample, with the for loop, okay, normal distribution, exactly the same stuff. We can define temporal models. Okay, we explain here how to define a simple temporal model for the temperature. Okay, like a kind of Kalman filter. This is what you would find in the notebook. Okay. Just give you a very high overview, okay? And we also ask you to provide an implementation of a bit more sophisticated ice cream shop model with the temperature. One day depends on the temperature of the previous day, and the humidity of one day depends on the humidity in the previous day, okay? Because before that, we've seen that they are dependent, but now they are temporally dependent, okay? That can be done in Pyro, with Pyro sample, distributions, for loops, okay, with the very basic construct that we have seen, all these kind of different models can be done in Pyro, okay? And then we will leave you this exercise, okay? We don't have time to go on that, sorry. Because we want to work a bit with a real data sample, okay? And I think it's going to help you a bit in order to understand which are the advantages of having a probabilistic approach to machine learning, okay? So, I'm going to start with this. Here, what you can see is this is a real data set, okay, that we found. up there. So these are non-African nations, these are African nations. This is called kind of terrain preparedness index. It's about the bad geography, okay, of a country. And this is the GDP in local scale, the GDP, you know, okay? So this, in this study, the authors found that this is to be like a negative correlation, okay, between the readiness index and the GDP of a nation, okay? But they found that in Africa, it seems to be like the other way around. So a bad geography, okay, seems to be associated to a better performance, in a better economic performance in terms of GDP. Okay? So in this study, the authors, what they did was maybe just to build a linear regression. Okay? Perfect. Then the linear regression okay, they try to predict the GDP based on the readiness index of the African of the countries, okay? So for non-African countries, it was kind of negative slope, okay? So seems to be like bad geography is a bad economic performance, but when we look only at the African nations, we can see that seems to be a positive slope, so seems to be like positive correlation, okay? So the question is, can we really trust these conclusions? Okay, that is the question that we can say, because there are not too many factors. Okay? So what we are going to illustrate in this part is how, using Bayesian approach, we can really have much more meaningful inferences and also account for different grades on the okay? And we are going to use just to build the Bayesian counterpart of a linear regression model. Okay? Very simple, linear regression model. So when we do Bayesian learning, okay, what we really account is for uncertainty. Okay? So we are going to model here two kinds of uncertainty, okay, that cannot be captured by a standard linear regression. The first uncertainty is like it's related to the noise that is in present in the data. Okay? For example, if I have this linear regression model, okay, and then I want to make a prediction about which is the GDP of a country with its readiness index is equal to 2, okay, I will give, you know, this prediction more or less, okay? But can you see that it's a lot of noise? It can be any of these ones. So if I give only this point estimate, I'm not giving a right answer. Okay? On the other hand, I'm sure this is the line that best fits. This is the only possible line that best fits the data, especially here when I have so few data samples. Okay? There is something which is called model uncertainty or epistemic uncertainty. Okay? So, as long as I have a small data sample, I mean a finite data sample, which is like all the data samples that I have, okay, I cannot be 100% sure about this is the right model. Okay? But using a Bayesian approach, we are going to see that it is possible to capture also this uncertainty in my model, and also in the kind of conclusion that I extract from the data. Okay? So, what we do, I'm going to do is to make a Bayesian linear regression model, which graphical representation is something like that. Antonio has been speaking about that this morning. And this can be easily encoded, okay, within Pyro, okay, using a Bayesian linear regression. And then I'm going to show you how to do it. Yes, okay, see. So, the question is, I define first here the weights, okay, perfect. Then I define the bias of my linear regression model, okay, but I define as a probability distribution as a random variable, okay. And then here we find the observations, okay, but now I say that they follow a normal distribution whose mean is the linear combination between the data and the coefficients plus the intercept in some given noise, which is parametrized by another random variable, which is the precision of the normal distribution. Okay? So the idea was to give you this as an exercise. Okay, actually, if you go to the student's notebook, you will see that there is gaps that you should fill in. Okay, so I invite you to start running the notebook from the beginning. Okay. Download the data. Then you will see how you can really reproduce all the linear regression. Okay. Do that by yourself. Figure out the plots. Perfect. This is other slopes, and this is how the Bayesian linear regression. And then you will find here, in this part, okay, how to define a Bayesian linear regression model. Perfect. So maybe you can just go to the code, okay, type yourself the solution because we are running a bit late. Okay? And then we can move, and then I can try to give you the impression of what we get when we are Bayesian. Okay? And we're going to use Bayesian modeling in a standard machine learning model, like a machine learning problem, like fitting a linear regression model. Okay. So take your time. You have here the solution that is going to be easy. Okay. Run everything, and then we will see what happens. Perfect. Now maybe you want to say something, Thomas?
Okay. We don't have that much time left, so we are supposed to finish by 4:30. So I just say a few last things, and before we end here. I hope that you all had a chance to go through the notebook and look a bit at the background of the data and the linear regression model, and also complete this part here of the code. And what I just want to do here towards the end is to emphasize the Bayesian aspect of this model here. So where we put up our prior distribution on the intercept over here, so we have a probability distribution over the intercept, and we have a probability distribution over the weights that relate, for instance, the bucket net index to the GDP. If we now start to look at what we actually get out of this in comparison to just a linear regression model. So the first part here is that we can explore the aleatoric uncertainty. So, and let's mention that, okay, even though that you fix the ruggedness index here, you can see that there is uncertainty in the GDP up here. And we can express, we have a get from our model specification in Pyro, we get a probability distribution over this part of the uncertainty of the model. So we could, for instance, besides the linear regression line that we have here, we could also indicate sort of an area where most of the probability mass falls. So this is my expectation here, and I have a probability distribution that lies with 95% of this probability mass within this region here, and I can do that for both non-African and African countries. But I can also go a bit further than that, because if you recall from our model, we also have probability estimates of our weights. So with the linear regression model, you only get one weight estimate, and you get one line up here, and that's the line that you have to work with. But with our Bayesian approach, we get probability distributions over the weights. That means that we have a distribution over linear regression models, because we have a distribution over the weights. And from this distribution over weights, we can define different weight values. Each weight value, or configuration of weight values, specifies a linear regression model. And this is what we try to illustrate here. Each line here represents a draw from the posterior distribution over the weights, which corresponds to a linear regression model that we have learned. And the same thing over here. So what you can see is that even though the linear regression giving you one line, and that one line to work with our Bayesian approach here, we actually get multiple lines that also captures the epistemic uncertainty that we have in our domain, the uncertainty that we have about our model. And you can see that it's actually quite valuable to be able, if you want to do predictions based on this, being able to express how confident you are in your estimates becomes quite vulnerable, especially if you move over here, where in the regions where we have a relatively low number of data points, we also have much more uncertainty in our estimates. So this is one of the things that you can get out of it. And you can also couple these lines here with these plus minus two standard deviations here, and then also get an even better expression of the spread of our probability distribution in our estimates. Lastly, you can go in and look at what is then, how does terrain ruggedness versus GDP look for African and non-African nations? Is there actually this difference between an increasing slope or a decreasing slope? And these are the density curves here that we can find, or the probability distributions that we can find, based on the posterior distributions that we have for the weights associating terrain ruggedness with GDP. So it's the one weight that relates to terrain ruggedness that we plotted here for African nations here and for non-African nations over here. And although we can say that there's a tendency, or that most of the probability mass or the probability distributions here seem to indicate that indeed there is a positive slope over here and a more tendency to a more negative slope for non-African nations, there is also a good overlap here where one would not draw that conclusion. And this is one of the things that you can capture with your probability estimates, your posterior probability estimates over your weights. You can start to reason about and express your uncertainty about the models that you actually learn, which is obviously valuable if you want to make some hard decisions based on the observations that you find. That was not quite what we had planned to say today, but that was what we had time to say today. So we had actually planned another small exercise that you can play around with if you don't have anything else to do tonight. So here you should try to revise your model here from doing linear regression to logistic regression. So it's a small change in the notebook, and what you want to do here is to predict whether a country is an African country or non-African country based on GDP and terrain ruggedness. So it's just a small change in the notebook. And we have put up the solutions to all these exercises here, so you can also go through it and simply see what we've done here and experiment with minor modifications in the model. Yes, we'll continue with this tomorrow and also Wednesday, but yeah, I think that was what we have time for today. Any last questions? Yeah?
Could you just go back to the slide statement? So is it that we can for sure say that African countries have a negative score, and African countries
may have
an example?
That would be what is good. Exactly.
So the idea is that we don't have enough data to be sure, you know, 100% or 99%. There is a positive relationship between the ruggedness index and the GDP in an African nation. There is some probability mass, there is some possibility that the relationship tends to be negative instead of positive. So the only thing to solve this question is to have more data. Okay? So.
Doesn't seem to work.
Yeah, it works.
Could you do some hypothesis testing thing of the bias factor to see where I work?
I don't think it's going to work. So that is here. I didn't hear that. Yeah.
it's not something that we can explore that part. But
value factor is not related. I have two different models. Okay, he's asking about how that relates with bias factors. Yes, I mean, bias factor is a different concept. Okay, bias factor is when I have two different models and then I want to know which one fits better. Okay, so imagine that here I have a linear model, but I may have a quadratic model. Okay, then I can compare which one fits better in my data. Okay, this is something different. Okay, is that I have a parameter, so I'm interested to know whether the parameter is positive or negative. Okay? So if you make a linear regression, then you say it's positive. Okay? But if you make a Bayesian linear regression, you can say with high probability it's positive. But there's also some probability that may be negative. Okay? So the question is maybe by chance that the sample that I have gives me this impression that it's a positive relationship. But I cannot be 100% sure that this is positive. Okay, but it may be by chance of the specific small sample that they have. Okay, so if I have more sample, it can happen two different things. We may concentrate on the mass probability on the positive side, or we may end up on the negative side. Okay, we need more data. So the question is, when we extract conclusion, we can really extract the conclusion, we can really say, well, for non-African nations, there is a negative relationship. But for African nations, seem to be positive, but we are not 100%. And this is something that you can do with Bayesian approach, but not with a linear relationship. Okay.
But maybe just to add, you'll never be 100% sure, because you'll never have enough data. You'll always have some degree of uncertainty in your estimates, because of the prior that you've specified. Yes. Yes.
More questions? Okay. Okay. So, see you tomorrow.